Bonnie's family, I would like to say thank you to you all who come today offering support and comfort. And thank you, of course, to Polly's family for giving us this time together, for offering us this time to come together and be together as the church that Polly served so faithfully and so wonderfully. Now, we have come from different places, and we all are at different stages on our journey through life, and our paths are varied. We all look at life from very different ways, but each of you comes with your own unique memories and experiences of Polly. For she was not the same person to any two of us, and you each bring your own special memories of this woman who touched your lives in a myriad of ways. But there is one thing that we have in common. At one point or another, and to some degree or other, our lives have touched the life of Polly Ann Hinckley. And so this afternoon, we put aside our usual daily activities for a while. We have gathered here to pay our respect and to bid a very fond farewell to Polly, so that in our own way, we celebrate, we honor, and we pay tribute to her life. Of course, thanking God for it as well. This is why we call it a celebration of life. A life that was lived with devotion to her family, service to her church, and dedication to her profession as a teacher. And we gather in this place where many of us came to know Polly through worship and choir, through teaching and friendship, in whatever way you may have known Polly. Be assured you are welcome, and we offer a welcome to those who are also joining us via live streaming. Because we gather under God's protective embrace, we are free to express ourselves in however way we need to. Sometimes words escape us, and so do our tears, so do our deep sighs. All of these are expressions of love that are fine and okay and safe to express, because this is that safe place. And there will be a time to raise our voices in song. Now, when that time happens, so two things have to happen, okay? When the time comes for song, I'm going to encourage you to stand and raise our spirits to God if you are able. Otherwise, you remain seated. But we're going to sing loud. We're going to use our outside voices. Okay? And we're going to sing proud, okay, because Polly loved music. The other reason for you to sing loud is to drown out my voice. And my congregation knows this. They know I can't sing, but they know I love to sing. So you're going to help this whole, this is going to be a healing process, okay? You're going to sing loud and you're going to sing proud, because Alex has been also practicing a lot, as you could already tell from the wonderful prelude that he provided. And while we gather to celebrate Polly's life, we gather as God's faithful people, certainly to be nurtured by God's grace and God's mercy, to hear God's words of hope. And so, my friends, let us open ourselves to God's healing presence. Now, in the New Testament, Christ often used the symbol of light to express love and concern for the world. It is written in John 8, verse 12, when Jesus spoke, saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but have the light of life." And so we have lit our candles here on the altar. We have lit the Christ candle and the other two candles, because within each human being, there is that spark of divine and eternal light, which exists beyond the time of beyond our time here on earth, but into the truth of eternity. And so we have lit these candles to honor the light and the light of Polly Ann Hinckley. And we light, in lighting this candle, we call forth the love and the light of Polly's spirit. And we all knew Polly, she had a lot of spirit. Right? She had a lot of love. And we also light this candle And in doing so, God recognizes our worship. As simple as it may seem, the prayers that are offered, the songs that will be sung, all of this will be received as praise for Polly's life. If you'll join with me in our call to worship, your words are printed for you in your bulletin. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die."
Lord, is my life and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?
They that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings with eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Come, let us wait upon the Lord. Our first hymn this afternoon is one of Polly's absolute favorite hymns. Hymn number 306, For All the Saints. Now we're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4. You can turn to hymn 306 in the blue hymnal. That is the pilgrim hymnal, which was her preference for hymnals. We're doing everything Polly's way today.
Thank you.
We pray for you to surround us with your comforting love. Give us the strength and the wisdom we need for this time of sorrow, this time of mourning, but also for this time of celebration for a life that was so well lived. We need the strength to face and endure our loss, but we need the wisdom, your holy wisdom, so that we see beyond the shadow of death and toward the fullness of your life, known to us in our brave Savior, our gentle Redeemer, Jesus our Christ. Amen. Now that your voices are warmed up from song, we're going to read together Psalm 23, that beautiful psalm that reminds us God is ever our shepherd. Let us join our voices together. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness. Yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow, I fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell. Now, no one person and no one hour can sum up the life of another. Certainly not how. Rather, it must remain as it is remembered by those who loved her, those who lived with her, those who worked with her, shared with her. For such memories are alive, unbound by the events of birth and death. And as living memories, we possess one of the greatest gifts that one person can give to another, those memories. And while many of us have memories of Polly, there are a couple of us that have chosen to share with us their remembrances and reflections of her life and the impact that she had on them. One such person is our choir director, our organist. I just think Alex is amazing. I think Polly did too, for different reasons. But anyway, I want to invite Alex Chu to come forward and speak his remembrances. Sure, and I'll even move my step aside.
Oh, good. First off, I just wanted to say, I'll offer my thanks to Ernie and Cindy and Arnold and Kevin for letting me speak, for giving me the opportunity, and also my sympathy for Polly. For those of you that don't, well, you know, this line made a lot more sense without the trick. I'm the music director and organist here, and I first met Polly in 2011 when the church was looking for a new music director. So I think I kind of wanted to go over maybe my impression of what Polly was with the church, sort of how much Polly meant to the church and how much the church meant to Polly. And so I remember actually Polly and Arnold were the first people I met. Walked in right through those doors, and I remember, you know, interviewing, and I remember calling my parents on the way home and saying, like, I don't think it's a good match. Probably won't be. And I that's honestly what I remember thinking. And I remember thinking that, you know, Polly was fiercely a loyal, fierce person, and she could be intimidating. She was very precise about what they were looking for a music director. She knew practically everything about everyone in the congregation. She'd point people out, just know everything about, which was incredible. And really, for all intents and purposes, she really was the organizing force behind a lot in the music department. And you don't believe me, go look upstairs, ignore my desk, and then look at the file system that she had. She dated and, you know, wrote everything on all the music. So really, she managed every aspect of that coming in, which was intimidating. But even though I remember that as saying, you know, phone call and saying, I don't think I'll stay, it's not for me, I think Polly and Arnold really were the reason that I ended up staying. Polly really wasn't afraid to tell people how it was. She really was, she would give you, you know, the honest opinion on it, but I think when she was on your side, she was the most loyal friend anyone could ask for. You know, my prime example I think of is when I started out in the choir, we would meet in the lounge every Thursday. I see members of my choir here, so they know it's a true story. I wasn't really very confident in piano. I'm actually avoiding it today, but that's just because Polly wasn't with me. So I wasn't very confident, and you know, it was kind of a miracle they would follow me in some ways. And I remember I would be up there practicing, and inevitably Polly and Arnold would come in half an hour early while I'm practicing and getting everything ready. And I just think we remember playing an arrangement of Sheep May Safely Graze, and I was doing it very, very poorly. I was messing up and everything. And you know, I would say, like, I don't really know this one very well, which wasn't true. I just wasn't playing it. And I remember Polly saying, like, oh, well, no one likes that one. So you know, I would go upstairs and get a new one. And for everyone that doesn't know, like, Sheep May Safely Graze is by Johann Sebastian Bach. So, like, that's the only organist anyone knows, and everyone likes Bach. So, totally untrue. I think, you know, for her to say that, someone that loved music and loved the organ so much, I really do honestly feel that that was to save my feelings of not being able to play it more than not liking the song. So that's really what I remember, and that was very early when I started, so that really was very meaningful. Another trait about Polly's that I remember is that she could tell the same story maybe 5-10 times, and it was always consistently the same. And sometimes they're fairly long stories. I can't tell you how many times I heard about how she and Arnold went through the same school system. And I remember her saying, and this isn't her words, it's not mine, but I remember her saying, yeah, when we were in school together before college, I thought he was a real jerk. So that's her words, not mine. I remember her telling stories about her teaching career, where she had a student that was trying to argue that state that he had lived in was a separate country from the U.S., like an entirely different state. I remember her saying she was trying to check out a library book at the University of Connecticut, and it had been checked out by a professor that was dead before she was even at the university. So, and I'm sure that everyone here knows these stories that I'm talking about, because she did tell these, and she was an excellent storyteller. You know, you would really, I think one of the benefits of her telling the stories so many times that sometimes somebody will tell a story once and you totally forget. With Polly's stories, you really, you sort of hear them, and you know, you really get a sense that it's the same stories that she's telling, and you know, it really gives you an opportunity to remember and connect. And this isn't to say that her memory was the cause of repeated stories, and I have an example for this too. When they moved into the creamery, shortly after I went to visit, and Polly would ask about specific events in people's lives here. She even asked me how my brother's wedding was, and this is at a time when I am still calling my sister-in-law my brother's fiance. And I was like, oh, I guess that did happen. So her memory was so sharp. She could remember details about everyone specifically. Really, in the church, she really wanted to know what was going on in people's lives. And so I remember that really was that stuck with me, is she really cared about people. She would really take the time to what was going on in people's lives and her memory. And I just wanted to also talk about Polly and the church. And last Sunday, we had a sermon on the church as a family. Not many people were here, so I'll just paraphrase a little bit about the church being a family. And I thought that to share that thought, I just would use Polly's own words. See, every year they would vacation to Wolfboro, Mass. And every year they sent me a postcard. And they wrote, you know, Polly would write a very long message in the postcard. Not long, but long for a postcard, as long as you could. We went to church yesterday. There was no organ music, just a pianist who made up as he went along. The minister had a short, boring sermon. We will all be glad to be back in our church this coming Sunday. All the best to the pop. And then the subsequent year, and I heard about it when they got back, you know, so it was much more detail. The following year, 2017, she wrote, "I hope things went well at church. Today, I changed the hymn numbers and put out offering plates at the workshop. We went to church in Wolfboro. The minister did a lot better job. She actually made sense." The organist, though, did okay. "Nothing like you. I can't wait to hear you play, and I can't wait to be back in our church." And what stuck out to me about this time, too, is that they frequently would bring me the bulletins, and I know for a fact, I looked at the music, and I was like, yeah, you're right, he's not as good as me, he's much better. No, that's good. That's tough music. So I think what sticks out to me is that all of them end, "I can't wait to be back at our church," or "we miss our church." And I think that that sounds exactly like what someone would say about family, you know? And I think when you think how strong-willed Polly was, I know a lot of people, you know, differences. She butted heads with some people on some things. I remember I was there in choir, so it would happen. But I think that that's part of being family too, because, you know, does anyone have a family that they don't argue with? They don't. But it's both sides of it, because she argued because she cared so much about it. And I think that letter puts it so well, because, you know, you can see that she's defensive, she comes around to liking the minister, you know, it's that same kind of shift. So I think that to me was emblematic of how Polly thought of the church as her family. And I also wanted to say thanks again for having me up, and I know I'm looking forward to meeting Polly again, but I'm not looking forward to explaining to all the other musicians, like, no, she didn't mean it. It's good intention.
There'll be a conversation, I'm sure, in the car ride back to Greenfield. Alex, if you want to take me back, it's over. I stand here not knowing what my mom would want me to stand here in. She'd want me to be in the minister room, but I'm not here in that room today. I'm here to carry on my favorite role, being the dutiful son. Cindy loves the favorite. But first, I'd like to thank all of you for being here to celebrate her life. She would be so touched by your presence. The one part where I will wear my professional hat for a second is, as I tell everyone that I work with when they go through these difficult times, that I really don't want the last 2 years of her life to be the defining moment of who she is, was, and will be. She had dementia, and she had just a part of it. And I say this lovingly, that I'm glad for her release of my body and spirit. I'd also like to thank all of you for your friendship and love and support to her and Dad. especially with the transition to Creamery. So, Mom grew up in Franklin, Connecticut on a chicken farm. So, she already knew about hard work, and she attended a one-room school from kindergarten through eighth grade. Now, for those of you who can remember the grumpy old men from Saturday Night Live, she did not walk uphill both ways in 10 feet of snow. But she did walk, I believe it was about half a mile, maybe a little more, maybe a little less. And there may have been times, I vaguely remember, I think Grandpa Crandall saying that sometimes she would take the horse to school, send the horse home, and then the horse would come back to pick her up at the end of school. She was also very active in the town's 4-H program, farming, homemaking, and I believe this had a big impression on her life because she always looked forward to going to the Big E in Springfield to check out all the buildings, the booths, or going to branch fairs for meals. She did attend and graduate Windham High School in 1956, and what gets me is that I had some of the same teachers she I know those of you who are here, Louis Stanzio. There was one other teacher, but anyhow. This is where she met Dad. I don't remember the full story, though Alex filled this in a bit, but I think it was she was a bit suspicious of the good-looking and wonderful guy that she would end up marrying in August of 57. And I'm going to guess that it took a little while for his sense of humor and constant teasing to grow on her. Education was important to her. She graduated from UConn in 1960 with a degree in teaching and then taught home economics at Lyman Memorial High School. She left that position to have Cindy, and then she went back to school to get her master's at UConn in 1965 and ended up teaching in Colchester for the rest of her life at the Johnson Middle School and Bacon Academy High School until her retirement in 1992. She loved teaching. She loved working with kids, and she looked forward genuinely to each school year. I know she retired a little bit sooner than she had planned, but she helped young people with the skills of cooking and sewing, baking, and how to run a home. And I think about it, this was so suited for her because that's what she liked to do. She liked to cook, bake, and sew. I was giving some Facebook memories from a Colchester page. Many of the former students wrote wonderful memories about her, about making aprons with Polly, about learning how to close a cabinet when you opened it in the kitchen. That when you measured any dry substance, you just didn't stick the cup in there, that you had to take a knife and go right across the top of the measuring cup. One student said, "Mrs. Hinckley should have given me an A plus on my project instead of a B. But if I'm honest, I should have gotten a D." Now, sometimes I got to help grade projects, usually the cooking and the baking. It wasn't as good as it may sound because very few of her students could bake as well as Mom. And yet, for me, and for Cindy, and for Dad, I don't ever remember store-bought cookies in our house. And I will tell you this, she could make cookies really well, and I could eat them very fast. And everything she made was from scratch. And in a typical New England swamp Yankee spirit, nothing went unused. When she would make pies, she would make her own pie crust. And then there would be the inevitable part of pie crust left over, and she would make the homemade cinnamon rolls, which became the center of heated arguments of who got how many, especially between my sister and I. And if Dad was home, it was the quick and the hungry. The only key about those cinnamon rolls was that they were in for about 8, maybe 10 minutes. And in the rush to have them, sometimes we didn't let them fully cool down, so that first bite was always wonderful. Mom was also an accomplished seamstress. She made her own wedding dress and clothes that Cindy and I wore, especially Easter outfits. There is living proof in pictures up in Fellowship Hall. One of my daughters saw one of the outfits she made for Easter. There's a picture of me standing right, probably where Reverend Mary Ann is. And she said, how did you let Grandma do that to you? And I said, I didn't have a choice. I remember summers. Mom would take Cindy and I constantly to Rocky Neck Beach or trips to Columbia Lake. She was always patient with both Cindy and I don't really remember her punishing us at all. I know that I could push it, because that's what sons do, right? Like, I knew the point, and the point was, wait till your father gets home. And that's all she needed to say to correct any of my errant behavior. Mom was always on time, as Alex testified. Choir rehearsal was what, at 7 or 7:30? Mom was always there half an hour early. Mom's not a trait that I inherited from my mom, and she reminded me of that at every chance she got, and I told her I showed up on time the day it counted, and that was the due date of my birth, 1206. Mom was at as many events for Cindy and I. It was actually very rare for her not to be there. Mom was an advocate, especially for Cindy, going to the schools that Cindy went to make sure that Cindy was trained and learned and was educated, and always talk about a woman with a backbone. I was on this side of the phone, so glad I wasn't on that side. She was also a very avid scrapbooker. Scrapbooked everything. There are scrapbooks for every family vacation, community events, and there was one that it was thankful to have it explained to me. When Mom was in high school, she was the president of the Future Homemakers of America, and she got to go to a convention in Chicago and stayed at the Hilton Hotel. And she saved everything and put it in a scrapbook. And I mean everything. Like, she took probably the thing you shouldn't take from the back of the door to prove that she was there. She took the bar of soap that comes, and she put it in the scrapbook. But as I thought about it, for someone who grew up in Franklin, Connecticut in 1956, she probably never thought she'd get there. It was already said, she was devoted to the family, meticulous planning for teaching. She also had a budget for the family. Not that I knew what it was, or nor that I cared, but often I heard, hey, I want that. No, you can't have it. Why? Because it's not in the budget. Oh, okay. Yeah. And it was a budget not only for the day, the week, but for each month and for each year. But her and Dad also budgeted so well that on the family vacations, and there were many, she kept track of every single dime that was spent. And then it was in 1978, I believe, that we started going to Wolfboro, New Hampshire, and they went there, I believe, every year up until COVID hit. I know Mom loved this church and serving on various communities and singing in the choir and being part of the music ministry. One of the few regrets I have for Mom was that I wish that her mind and body and spirit had lasted longer, only so that she could pass along the knowledge and the recipes of baking with Julia and Alexandra, who come by their love of baking quite naturally. I will say, as her son, I often took joy out of teasing her about anything. Anything and everything. She'd ask me, how was the pie at Thanksgiving? Yeah, it was edible. It was delicious, it really was. But just to see if I could get a rise out of her, and Dad, I don't know how you got blamed for my angelic behavior. Now, the one thing in my life that was interesting was my call to ministry. Mom knew that before I did, that I would become a minister. The only mistake I think she made with this knowledge was telling me when I was a teenager. And it may have been one of the few times that I used some very, very colorful language in her presence about not wanting to be a blessed minister. Really, the hardest part of accepting my call to ministry was telling Mom that she was right. Now, Marianne, I need to tell you something. This is not personal, but this is so Polly. You were not her first choice to succeed your predecessor. I only know that because when the letter went out, she called me immediately to see if I was interested in being the minister here. Which I wasn't.
Thank you.
You're so welcome. As Alex said, you know, she critiqued ministers, but I think my mom was always gentle with me. Oh, you gave the best sermon. And one time I was like, what part of that sermon did you like? Because I did not like any of it. But she asked me why. Why don't you want to be the minister here? I was like, Mom, I'm not going to be your minister. I can't be your minister. Also, I'm not moving my kids to Columbia. Not a knock against Columbia. My kids are entrenched in Wharton. And I, as I would also tell her, God has not called me to leave yet. I also told her, Jesus showed me how things went when you preach in front of the hometown. And since I believe in following Jesus, I should stay where I am. Mom, I want to thank you for all you did and will continue to do for Dad, for Cindy, for Julia and Alex and myself, for modeling love of God, neighbor and self, for showing me what a loving relationship with a partner is like, for the unconditional love of being a parent and a grandparent. The other thing that remembered as I was writing this was that some of you who are here know this, that in one of the winter storms of 82, Dad was called into work and he nicked the back of his hand and he got what was a staph infection. He was in the hospital quite a period. It was actually the first time I saw him cry. Huge moment. But forever, how long that Dad was in Wyndham Hospital. She modeled grace under pressure. I never saw her worry or show concern. And one of her students also wrote that she modeled this grace under pressure and she lived life in the present, moving forward with the challenges, which modeled to show that we can continue to move forward and make the best of each day if we choose to. So, there are many things to thank you for. I will spend the rest of my life trying to model that and live the lessons that you taught me. I'm grateful for the gifts you've passed on to the family, to this community of faith, and to those you knew and that you loved, and to those you taught for so many years. I close with the words that, Mom, that you spoke to me on the day I was ordained here. She made a stole for me. I never had the heart to tell her that she made it too short. But she said that on the last day that you finish your ministry, may you hear the words, well done, good and faithful servant. Thank you.
The poet Emily Matthews says this about memories. She says, our memories build a special bridge when loved ones have to part to help us feel we're with them still and soothe a grieving heart. They span the years and warm our lives, preserving ties that bind. Our memories build a special bridge and bring us peace of mind. And it is each of us, then, that the living memories of Polly's life are committed. It is to our hearts and minds, to our hearts and minds will the enduring remembrances of her life. And I know that there are a lot of memories to share, and we have a time of sharing that's being offered. After worship, we will join together in the, and you're all invited to join with us up in the fellowship hall, where you can see some of these wonderful photographs and also share some of your own memories with Pablo's family. But let us bless the remembrances that have just been shared with us with a word of prayer. God of love, we thank you for all that Polly was to each of us. And so we ask you, you who created her, you who fashioned her, and you who now gather her into your heart, to bless our memories and the remembrances of her, that she may continue to live within our hearts, inspiring and encouraging us in all things good. Many more memories reside within our hearts, and it's there, O God, that we ask you to lay your holy hand and bless us with the gift of your abiding presence. That gift of your abiding presence and that gift of your promise that in the days following our grief, we come to know the joy of the memory shared, and our hopes for the future give us strength and peace. Amen. And so now is another opportunity for you to rise up and bring your voices into this wonderful time of gathering, this time of celebration. Another of Holly's favorite hymns is number 251, Holy, Holy, Holy. I'm so glad that she liked all the hymns that I liked.
Thank you.
express our gratitude for the days and the years that we were able to share with Holly. And we are here to remember and memorialize a very good and a very caring life. And we do that by remembering the best of Holly, by recalling some of her finest qualities as Alex and Bernie did, and by honoring her principles, her values, and dreams which guided her life. And thank you for not accepting. Thank you again. I know that many of you experienced Holly in a variety of ways, and one of the many things I appreciated about Holly, one of the things, was her honesty, her wisdom. You all touched on it in your former remarks. And so, speaking honestly, when I was presented with this opportunity to eulogize her, and granted, I had plenty of opportunity, you know, I had plenty of forewarning about this, but I prayed. I often pray, and I pray often, but what I mean is I really prayed about this because I thought, how can I encapsulate, what can I say about someone that all of you have known so much longer, and where do I even begin? And so I prayed for wisdom. And while I was praying, I realized the biblical wisdom literature is exactly where I needed to rest. It's where I needed to be. And when I realized I should begin with the wisdom literature, I knew it had to be Proverbs 8. Chapter 1, verses 1 to 11, where it is written, "Does not wisdom call out? Does not understanding raise her voice? At the highest point along the way where the paths meet, she takes her stand beside the gate leading into the city at the entrance, and she cries aloud, 'To you, O people, I call out. I raise my voice to all mankind. You who are simple, gain prudence. You who are foolish, set your hearts on it. And listen, for I have trustworthy things to say. I open my lips to speak what is right. My mouth speaks what is true, for my lips detest wickedness. All the words of my mouth are just. None of them is crooked or perverse. To the discerning, all of them are right. They are upright to those who have found knowledge. Choose my instruction instead of silver, knowledge rather than choice gold. For wisdom is more precious than rubies, and nothing you desire can compare to her." Because it is there in the very beginning of this text that we hear wisdom calling out to all people from the places of human interaction and discourse. She calls from the economic and judicial centers of exchange, the crossroads and the gates, but she also calls from those ordinary places of life, those places where the ordinary people gather and go about doing the ordinary things of life. Wisdom cries out to all that live and for the simple to receive instruction. And from these verses, we can understand wisdom is a prophetess, a preacher, one who stands amidst the people calling for attention. Because the voice of wisdom is that voice of an earnest friend who lets us know when something is amiss or something is seriously wrong or that we are in danger. It is exactly because of that love that wisdom has, that wisdom speaks to us, hoping to keep us safe. She does not work quietly behind the scenes, but is that guiding force in all human affairs. Now, a big part of wisdom is expectations. That word, expectations, It's a big word. Four syllables, expectations. Yep, four syllables. But the meaning, it's big for the meaning that it connotes, right? We're not always totally comfortable or secure about having expectations asked of us. The fact is, you simply, you know, we cannot have wisdom without having expectations, because otherwise, what you have is just information. And you have knowledge for sure, but nothing to do with it, right? In order for information and knowledge to work for you, for any of us to gain wisdom, is we need some expectations to come from that knowledge. Polly did not lack for expectations. I know I'm sort of stating the obvious. And maybe there were times when her expectations felt stifling to some of us or unrealistic, but here is the thing. I know, I speak from my own experience, and I probably have known her the shortest, is that I am a much better off person and minister and pastor having had those expectations than not having them. Because Polly's expectations, as you've already heard, came from a place of love. They were born from hope. It may not have always felt like the most loving in its presentation sometimes, but it is because she loved her church that she strove for us to become more faithful and more earnest in our work and in our worship. It is because she loved her friends that she strove to bring hope to them by remembering those important dates, important things about them, sending cards and notes, reminding people they were not forgotten. It is because she loved her family that she strove to care for them in every way she knew she could. Gifts of outfits and countless meals and things that she baked. And here's the other thing about Polly. She didn't shy away when expectations were put on her. We know it from the work that she did as a teacher. We see it in the work that she did for her church and for her denomination, serving in many, many ways, certainly being a delegate for her church. Polly had a lot of wisdom, not only through her academic accomplishments, but through her life and through her faith and her beliefs. That's how I came to know her wisdom, through her faith. The very last time I got to see her was the Friday, just days before she passed away. And she could barely keep her eyes open. She couldn't really speak too much, but she said to me, "You're from the church, right?" And I said, "Yes." And then we started to say the Lord's Prayer. And she couldn't really speak the words, but she knew what was being said. She had a lot of wisdom. It was her faith and her beliefs that she took with her into the world. She didn't just save those for Sunday morning at 10 a.m. or for choir practice. No, she took her faith, she took her beliefs, and she took them to the crossroads, to the gates. She took them everywhere with her, as Bernie noted from some of her students. She took them into the world, and she did not hesitate to share them with whoever she encountered and wherever she might have been. And it takes courage. It takes courage to stand with conviction for what you believe, and Polly had that courage. In 1965, Polly did something that the majority of women at that time could not even fathom. She graduated from UConn with a Master's of Science. For a woman whose education began in a one-room rural schoolhouse, this was not easy, and nor was it the norm of the time. She earned that degree at a time when most women were expected to just stay home, bake the cookies, be the homemaker, all of which she did as well. But she had the faith and the trust and the wisdom. to know how and where to push the boundaries of conventional life. See, she looked beyond the borders of the cultural norm of that time, and she said, I'm heading over yonder. I'm going beyond. I'm going to discover more. And that she did, because she wanted more wisdom. I look at women like Polly, and I say, thank you. Thank you for having the wisdom and the courage to step beyond the boundaries, forging a path that the rest of us can follow. And she didn't waste her education. She went right to work employing her skills and her gifts for learning by teaching others so that they might become as learned as she. And in the few times I did speak with Polly about her teaching career, what I heard from her was that it seemed it was more about providing those she taught with a better understanding of their abilities than just imparting her knowledge to them. She wanted those who she taught to see beyond the boundaries like she did and to work towards something greater than themselves. She wanted those she taught to believe in themselves with that same conviction that she had. So she sought to teach them to have faith, to have belief, and to be convicted in that faith and in that belief. And we know that she was a very loving person in many, many ways. One of the ways that we know we are loved is not by what someone can do for us, but what they would do for us. You know, anybody can tell you what they could do. Polly was more apt to tell you what she would do, more than just what she could do. And this is how she set another example. She set an example for any of us who would pay attention and wanted to learn that what is true for all relationships, and certainly a relationship with God, is honesty with our intentions. And I believe that Polly always had the right intentions for trying in the only way she knew how to set hopeful expectations, with letting people know up front what she would do for them. And there is no mystery here. No one has to second guess or wonder about motive. We read in our scripture, we hear, listen, for I have trustworthy things to say. I open my lips to speak what is right. When I thought about that verse, I thought about a story with Polly, and I can tell you best, I guess I can speak best to this with a story. Actually, one of my lasting memories and a cherished memory for me. And it happened when I was visiting Arnold and Polly one day, and I was still getting to know Polly. We were still getting to know each other. And she was experiencing some decrease in her memory, but she was still aware enough to know that I was trying to get to know her. And so she invited me to go through some of her photo books and her scrapbooks. And somewhere along the way, I don't remember what exactly we were looking at, but somewhere along the way, I asked her a question that she'd been asked her whole life. Is Polly your nickname? Cherish, and I will never forget. Then she laid her hand said, "Oh, I'm sorry I yelled." He did. And I said, "Polly, I'm not sorry. I'm not sorry. It shows your spirit." And she held on to my hand. And holding hands together, we went through the rest of the book. And then she told me the story of how her great, I think it was her grade school principal, had questioned her about her name and how she went all the way home, got her birth certificate. And this is Polly, right? This is Polly. Went all the way home, got the birth certificate, brought it back, laid it on the table on the desk, and proved to him that her real given name is Polly. And what it says about Polly is that, again with wisdom, wisdom always sets the story straight. Sometimes we have to wait for it, but there is that truth that comes with it. Wisdom will always set the story straight. And Polly set the story straight. She made it right. She set the story straight because she wanted it to be right. And she was completely earnest and honest with me when she said she was sorry. I have no doubt about that. Wisdom does that. Doesn't mean that she was right about everything in life. But I think any of us would want people to remember the times that we tried to make it right. We want those times to be remembered than otherwise. And so why wouldn't we remember that about Polly? Choose my instruction instead of silver, knowledge rather than choice gold, for wisdom is more precious than rubies, and nothing you desire can compare with her. Polly took her faith and shared her beliefs, not only in church, but to the world, in the world, because she knew. She knew that the world needed more wisdom than anything else. And the joy for us is that we get to thank God for it. Amen. Now, because the last prayer I prayed with Polly was the Lord's Prayer, we're going to speak the Lord's Prayer together. And you can use whatever language is comfortable for you, whether it be temptation, sin, what's the other, debtors. We use sins here, but let's pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I always have to double check the bulletin. See, for me, bulletins are like a suggestion. All right. Oh, we're supposed to sing a hymn. All right, well, we got a little ahead of ourselves. That's okay. Oh, I guess we sang the hymn, and we already sang that hymn. Oh, but wait, first we're going to do a prayer. You know, in every one of us, there is this longing for home. It's a longing for a place where we are known, where we are accepted, where we are loved, just as we are. I always try to say, well, church is that place. It's a longing for a place where we're nurtured and guided. And God always calls to us. God calls to us, you can come home now. You can come home now. There is a home for you in my redeeming love. There is a home for you in my living word. There is a home for you in my eternal realm where all are welcome. God says all of this and promises all this throughout our lives and certainly into our dying. And so let us pray with words of God's assurance that Polly is at home with God. Ever living, ever loving God, We commend your beloved child, Polly Ann Hinckley, with certain hope of the resurrection through Jesus Christ. We pray, O God, to keep her in your loving embrace until we are all united again in your home. We pray these mercies in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Okay, now we can sing that final hymn that she loved, For the Beauty of the Earth. Hymn number 66, and we're singing verses 1, 4, and 6. So let us rise up if we're able and bring our spirits to God. Amen. Please be seated for the post-food.